Like to take advantage of that. Also, if there's a seat between you and someone else and you're saving it for them, I'm going to ask you to now begin to go ahead and release those seats and scoot together and provide people who are standing an opportunity to have a seat. God bless you today.
Good morning. If you can make your way to your seat, we're going to get started. On behalf of the Bell family, I'd like to welcome you to the memorial service in honor of our beloved friend, David Michael Bell. If you love the Jesus that you saw in David and you experienced from him and the Bell family, can we just applaud David and this Bell family today? Hallelujah. Do we have any Christians here today? Woo. Listen, as Christians, we believe that life is a gift from Almighty God. Do you believe that today?
Amen.
Dave, our friend Dave, was an exceptional gift of a man to us all. And this is what God's word says in Revelation 4:11. It says this: "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things." Can you say all things? "And by your will they were created and have their being." Do you believe God created you today? Hallelujah. So today, right now, we're going to join Dave in the heavenly chorus as they sing "Worthy." Can you say "Worthy"?
Worthy.
Can you say "Glory"?
Glory.
Can you say "Honor"?
Honor.
And "Power to our great God." Are you guys ready to do that?
Amen.
Why don't you raise your hands? We're going to pray. Raise your hands to the heavens. Let's position ourselves for worship today. I'm going to pray, and then after I pray, we're going to let a shout arise, and then we're going to enter into the presence of God, and we're going to praise our great God. So, Father, today, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the life you gave David Bell and how he lived his life as a living sacrifice for others unto you, Jesus. Lift your voices in prayer with me. Lord God, we thank you that he had a passion to experience and to help others experience the radiance of your glory. So today, we want to honor you and love you, Lord, like David did. Lord God, we're going to worship you like David did. And we thank you for his example. We thank you for his leadership. And as we do this, Jesus, we pray that your comforting would come, your salvation would come, your healing would come. And it would be a stream from heaven, flowing from the throne of God, from the river of life. We pray, oh God, comfort his family today. Comfort his friends. Comfort our church that Dave so dearly loved. Oh God, and we pray this in the strong name of Jesus. And God's people said,
amen.
All right, on the count of three, we're going to shout glory, and then we're going to start to praise our God. Are you guys ready? If you're ready, say, "I'm ready." On the count of three, I want you to shout glory as big as you can. One, two, three. Glory! Hallelujah!
exalt you now. With overflowing hearts, Jesus, we bless you. Lord, we proclaim your power. With overflowing hearts, there's only one God worthy of praise. Only one King who is able to save. Only one Lord. Strong and mighty tower, the righteous run in and are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong and mighty tower, the righteous run in and are saved. The righteous run in and are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong and mighty tower, the righteous run in and are saved. A strong and mighty tower, the righteous running and are saved. The righteous running and are saved.
Lift up the name of Jesus, his mighty acts proclaim. So show forth his praise in all the earth. Arise and bless his name.
Strong and mighty tower, righteous running and are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong and mighty tower, righteous running and are saved. Righteous running and are saved.
Lift up the name of Jesus, his mighty acts proclaim. Show forth his praise in all. Arise and bless his name. Lift up the name of Jesus, his mighty acts proclaim. Show forth his praise in all the earth. Arise and bless his name.
Thank you.
I need you. Sacrifice.
living sacrifice, more of you. Oh Lord, more of you.
Actually says as much about this man, David Bell, and his relationship with his Lord. Give Jesus a hand today. You may be seated. David Michael Bell, beloved husband, father, pastor, and friend, called home to be with the Lord this last Sunday morning, May the 6th. He was born October the 21st, 1954, here in San Antonio, Texas. In 1989, David left his successful software career of 13 years to pastor Destiny Church. It was then Revival Temple under his parents, John and Ruth Bell. And from 1996 to the present, he has served as lead pastor. The three main thrusts of David's ministry were worship, prayer and continuing the legacy of world missions that his parents had pioneered. David loved to see men of God rise up in worship and prayer. He was a passionate worshiper. David recorded and produced several albums and started Dancing Heart, a record label dedicated to raising up the next generation of worshipers. David's favorite activity was playing tennis with his wife, sons, and close friends. One of his greatest joys was sitting poolside with his three grandchildren. David always enjoyed his faithful wife and his children. David is survived by Jody, his wife of 32 years, his brother Nathan, five sons, Matthew, Michael, Mark, Micah, and Mitchell, all of whom are part of the ministry of Destiny Church. Three grandchildren, Heidi, Hunter, and Faith. David was integrity personified. He lived by faith every day of his life with the sole purpose and passion of advancing the kingdom of God. This past Sunday morning, stepping out of a crusade service in Ecuador, my wife and I there with missionaries Jerry and Sandy Owens and several from our church body, I received the word of David's homegoing and, of course, a thousand emotions and then immediate prayers for Jody and the boys and this body and for the work of the Lord. In a moment, a scene flashed before my attention when my wife and I, a few years ago, had walked into Westminster Abbey, stepped up to the tomb of John Wesley, and his memorable words inscribed in marble on his tomb: God buries his workmen, but he carries his work on.
Praise the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord is in this place. Can you feel it? Amen. This is not just a homegoing. This is a celebration of the glory of God's purpose and the workmanship of the Lord in his people. I'm Pastor Sam Eaton from Dallas, Texas. For those of you that do not know me, my wife, Daphne, who is a Denton, was the daughter of W.G. Denton, who was married to Faith Coote. Praise the Lord. We are part of a royal house. God's dealings in this life are his work and his workmanship. We are the clay and he is the potter. And I am so proud and excited to be a part of this celebration because David was a wonderful man of God. As my life goes back and our experiences with him in the early 60s, he was a very vibrant, energetic young man. I remember one Christmas we shared with the family as the Bells would come to Dallas and we would come to San Antonio and share our times together. And one Christmas morning, it was Timmy Coote and David Bell that were passing out the gifts. They got so excited with the family that they knocked down the tree. David was a passionate young man. He was passionate for new cars, different cars. And I don't know if you knew him like I did, but I happened to have a few fast cars, and he loved to test drive them every time he came to Dallas. Well, now he's into these new BMWs, which are fantastic vehicles. But as David was passionate for the things of this life, he was passionate more for God. And that's what excited me. When we were with him, the praise and the worship that just poured forth, he is a modern-day King David who brought forth the Psalms unto the praises of God. And it wasn't because he was so articulate in his expressions, but it was his desperation for the Lord. And my challenge to the young men that are sitting here, and for Jody, is this inheritance that God has left you will continue on to the praise and glory of God. This is not the end. This is the beginning. As God so graciously has imparted the gifts in our lives as we stand upon the pillars of giants, spiritually speaking, John and Ruth Bell and Brother Leonard Coote, we are a privileged and blessed generation. And may the Lord find the faith and response in us that is going to bring forth the fruit of the bounty of blessing tens of thousands, if not tens of millions, in all the earth. I give a tremendous support and blessing to Nathan Bell, who, a man in his later years, went to China and has become the head of orphanages. Only God can do that in a man. So we are God's workmanship, and David was God's workmanship too. And so I stand here before you, not with desperation or desire for longing, but I stand before you with hope for the glory of the kingdom to flourish and prosper in this generation, in these new young people that God is raising up. David was such a man that he had to leave five men to take his place. My prayers are going to be with Jody. Yes, this will be a divine adjustment, but God is capable. God is able. We have gone through such reverses in Dallas, the passing of my father-in-law in 1980, and I felt so ill prepared to take up the mantle of responsibility of ministry, but God brought forth the anointing, and the anointing breaks the yoke. And as you support this family continually in the purposes of God, you're not just supporting individuals, you're supporting God's elections and predestinations, as this church is called Destiny Church. Matthew, our prayers are with you. We know God has put a great heritage in the life, and I believe that through the anointing of God, it shall be fulfilled. Michael, God's purpose in you, and your name bears this tremendous responsibility, one who is like God. May the anointing of the Father also fortify you in your participation of the glories of the kingdom of God in San Antonio. Mark, there is a special destiny upon you, and God knows your heart, and he will fulfill the desires of your heart as you seek him and find his place for your life. So be a man of faith and reach into your destiny to fulfill it. Micah, you're named after a great prophet. And may the prophetic gift of God flow through your life to this generation. May the blessing of song and worship also continue in you as was in your father. And let the glory of the Lord arise in your life. Mitchell, the last but not least, in your desire to please the Lord, the Father will be satisfied. Seek him and you shall find him. glorify his name in all your decisions and desires. And God will lift you up and make you shine as a light in a dark world. Let the glory of the Lord fulfill all that is in your heart for him. And you will find the peace and the joy and the rest to share with those around you. This is a great privilege to be in the presence of this people. As I shared for a moment with David Coote yesterday in the family gathering up on the hill, I asked him, "What is the Lord saying to you, Uncle David?" And he says, "Well, the Lord's last commission when he ascended up to heaven was he blessed them. And so I bless you in the name of the Lord. And let this glorious time of celebration bring honor and praise to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who is working all things after the counsel of his will. In Jesus' name, God bless you all."
Well, I'm Wayne Beatles. I've been here for a while. Well, I'm usually not lost for words, but this is one of those times where Wayne and I and the Beatles joined in with the Coots and the Bells in 1948, before this great man had arrived on the scene. But his brother was about 4 years old or so. And my oldest son is just a month older than Nathan. So the two B's got into just about everything. They had some, if we had a couple hours, we could tell you some hair-raising events. Davy, as they called him, was a little more quiet. He didn't get into all those things that my son Ron and Nathan did. But he made his mark. And I want to say to Jody and the family, from the Beatles family, our condolences, our love, our caring, and we love you. You know, as Pastor Dave, as we knew him, was such a great guy. He was a down-to-earth person, not like his dad. His dad and I was privileged to be with John Bell all over the world for missions, and I appreciate the heritage of missions, and I was privileged to serve under John Bell and Dave as well, mostly Dave, about 6 years as missions pastor of this great congregation. You've been a great congregation. You've had a great heart for the world, and it will continue. And the leadership is still here. Although Dave is gone, the leadership to go on is forward. L.W. Coote's last word, I understand, was forward. And it's the theme that we still have, forward until Jesus comes. We don't know how long that'll be. Some of us are a little bit over the hill, but we're not under the hill, and we still believe forward. I got to say that Pastor Dave, probably in his growing up years, teenagers and on, didn't really have the thought of being pastor of this great church. But you know, God orchestrated ways that man doesn't always understand, and most of the time does not understand. And the, one of the other understandings is we don't understand why he took him at age 57. But God does everything right. And he knows exactly, as we move forward, what God is going to do. And we believe strongly that God's going to show the leadership here what's going to be best for you guys. We love you. Pastor Dave didn't come into any pulpit without sometime during the place doing two things. One was he said, I love you guys. I love you. And he never closed a Sunday morning service without saying, we want to see if there's anyone here that does know Jesus. And he led the congregation in saying a prayer of repentance and committal to God. And if he was standing here now with this great crowd, that would be his heart to do that. And it wouldn't be a bad idea, but we're not going to take time to do it right now. I just want to say the years that I served under Davis, lead pastor, I cherish those, and I cherish the love of destiny. And I know that we're going to continue that in memory of the great Dave Bell. As Sam already said, he was a worshiper like King David. David was a man after God's own heart. He wasn't perfect, like David would say to us, not like John Bell. He would say, oh, well, we had a bad week this week. You would never heard John Bell say that. But he did. He was a down-to-earth person. He didn't stand up here and you down there. He was a part of you as you were a part of him. Amen. So I count it a great privilege, but I'm not finished yet. I'm finished with this speech, but I'm not finished with the kingdom of God and with destiny. I'm committed, as long as I have breath, to use what little bit of wisdom I have to help leadership to go forward for the kingdom of God. And I pronounce a blessing to everyone here that you be a part of that in every facet. Amen. God bless you.
I'm Nathan Bell. And I'm going to try to say a few words about my brother. I'm going to try. You know, God's plan, whatever it is, no matter how strange it appears, sometimes, no matter how difficult it is to accept, is exactly what we would choose if we could see the whole picture. God's plan is what every person here would choose if you could see the whole picture. Now, we can't see the whole picture, but God can. My brother Dave Bell, I remember the first time I ever heard of him. And I'm going to tell you guys a few things you probably don't know. Some of you do, but not all of you. Mom was in the hospital. Dad came home, and I was sitting in the bathtub taking a bath. And Dad came in, put the seat down on the commode, the lid, the top lid down, sat down there beside where I was taking a bath in that very small bathroom at 722 Marquette Street, and began to cry, which was not a very common sight. And that pretty much scared me to death to see my dad sitting there crying. And he said, "Nathan, you have a little brother, but he's not expected to live. One of his lungs didn't expand like it should have when he was born." And I said, "Dad, what can we do?" And he said, "We can pray." Well, obviously, that portion of his life, the lungs expanded, and he became quite a vivacious little boy. Later in life, we went to Japan. Davy was, I think, about 2 years old when we went to Japan. And during that period of time, he contracted rheumatic fever. And I don't think anybody knew what it was at the time. In fact, I don't think we knew till much later what the problem was. But that eventually led to heart challenges. And in my memory, it seems like he had won a tennis scholarship to one of the colleges or universities here. I'm not sure about this, but this is what I vaguely recall. And he had to have a final physical. And at that time, they discovered that he had some heart issues that canceled out his being able to participate in that tennis scholarship. But David never let these physical problems slow him down. Do you know that he's the only person I know of, including these five young men over here, that have ever been able to take a two-wheel bicycle, set it up on a wheelie, ride it on one wheel all the way down Gainesboro, take the next street over, go all the way around the block, and come back to Mom and Dad's house without ever setting it down? Did y'all know that? I tried it. I think his weight balance was a little better than mine or something. He played tennis. He loved to play tennis. Everybody knows that. He loved to try to play golf. And really, you know, all this time, he basically overcame many of the physical ailments that he had. He could have taken it easy and given up, but he didn't. He was a fighter. He was always up for a challenge. Another part of my memory is his music. Now, you have to remember, years and years and years ago, we sang out of red songbooks. I remember when there was no such thing as choruses in church. It was turned to page 155. We'll sing verse 1, 3, 5, and the chorus two times. That's the truth. A lot of you newcomers probably don't have any idea what I'm talking about. And then somewhere along the line, some of the churches broke out in what they called choruses. I am determined, I've made up my mind, I'll serve the Lord. Just choruses. And that slowly evolved into what we know of today as praise and worship, the spontaneous praise and worship that we all so much enjoyed this morning. But Davy was an early on praise and worship leader. And I know none of you know this, but Dad had an old orange crate. in the backyard where we used to live at 722 Marquette Street. And I remember seeing my brother, he must have been 6 or 7. He would get that orange crate out in the backyard, stand on it, and say, "I'm Billy Band. I want everybody to stand up and sing with me as we worship the Lord." Have any of you ever heard of Billy Band before? Oh, you have, Jody? I didn't know that. That's the truth. That was a long, long time ago. And I would stop whatever I was doing. And I'd say, "Okay, you know, I'll praise the Lord with you. I'll sing with you." Oh, my goodness. Then, kind of in progressive time with the development of the praise and worship music, the choruses, and the moving into a different kind of song-type worship, Davey got interested in the piano. Oh, my goodness. I don't think he ever... Did he ever have piano lessons? I don't think so. But he would sit down at the piano and make some of the weirdest sounds you have ever heard. And, you know, I grew up playing the piano with the old common, you know, the tonic chord, the subdominant chord, the, you know, C, F, and G. And, you know, Davey was in the, 10, 14, 18, 97 flats and 27 sharps. And Mom and I used to talk about it. You know, what is with that guy? But then he got with Mark Witt, and I think Mike Heron maybe, sometime during that period of time, and they started developing this praise and worship type of music, and Davey excelled in that. And that has evolved into this wonderful way we enter into the kingdom of God here in the physical, in praise and worship. I'm so proud of my brother. And I have to tell you, it was about midnight when Michael called me and told me what had happened. And I was rather stunned, of course. And very quickly, the thoughts of why. I had heart attack a year and a half ago, had to have some minor heart surgery, much older than he is, not nearly as healthy as he is. So it was natural for me to, matter of fact, I'll tell you the truth, not long ago I wrote a document in China about how I wanted things to be handled when I passed on, with the orphanage work, the work there, the financial aspect. But the very beginning was what I wanted to happen to me, and it was my brother would come to China and take me back to the States. And if the Chinese government wouldn't allow me to be taken out of China, then he should feel at liberty to have me cremated and buried there in China. So I was just devastated when I got the news, because it was always my thoughts that I would go first. And that led to whys. Why? I never got to doubt, but I never got that far. But I was full of whys. Why did this happen? Why did this have to happen? You know, he was in the prime of his life. Why? And then it came back to me again. We don't know. But we don't have to know, because God does. And again, I would like to reiterate what I said. Nothing happens that isn't God's plan. And God's plan is what we would choose if we could see the total picture. And I'm just happy today to say, as sad as I am, as big a loss as this is, I am so happy that my brother Dave is in God's plan. Bless you very much. Bless the Lord. We have a hope in the resurrection. We never lose that hope as Christians. But I have another hope today. We all have another hope that's based on fact, and that is the continuity of God's work. We may lose certain vessels that have been used by God, but we don't lose the plan of God. We don't lose what God has purposed to come to pass. And today, we have the privilege to weep. Nothing wrong with it. But at the same time, there's a thanksgiving in our heart for God, His plan, and His vessels. As the Beatles said, my family and I have been having the privilege of working with these different men of this church from way back, probably 48. Leonard W. Coote, Esther Coote, and the family. John and Ruth Bell and family. David Coote and family. And in these last years since returning from Japan with David Bell and family. So we know a little bit about what we're speaking about today, the continuity of God's work. We have seen it and we're going to see it. Today we're honoring our beloved David Bell. And we will all have memories of him and his work. For truly the hand of God was upon him. And this work was carried forth, and another chapter has been written in this book. A wonderful chapter, a successful chapter has been written in the book concerning this church and the work of God in a church that's unique. Unique in the manner of its far-reaching influences. In Japan, in Mexico, and other countries, it has had an influence in churches that have been established there. This young man spent time as a kid in Japan. He spent time going to Japan and being used of God over there to bless the Japanese churches. And today, we can look forward and know that there will be a continuity of God's work. I'm glad to have the privilege of being a part of the plan of God and the work of God. And as I've mentioned, being able to work with these wonderful families. But God has a future for us. And the chapter that David was in is not the end of the book. There's other chapters perhaps that will be written. But we know that God has a purpose. And we can constantly believe that He will fulfill that purpose, and we have been called for some reason. We're still here today. And for the purposes of God, we want to go forward knowing that He has a continuity of the work that He has started. I want to read you something from our Japanese pastors. They couldn't be here today. And then I'm going to let it be put to voice. The
overall work here originated in Japan with L.W. Koo. And then it came to America, and then it's gone around the world. Happy is the man that hath his quiver full of arrows. Pastor David Bell is a good father and a good shepherd to churches around the world, has honorably completed the mission and responsibility he had received from the Lord, and has now departed to the kingdom of heaven to receive the crown of righteousness. The songs of spiritual warfare, the triumphant voices, the songs to lead the crowd into the presence of the Lord, many praise and worship pieces he wrote that give honor, glory, power, and might to the King will continue to be sung throughout generations and be heard around the world. The vision of church's greatest commission your great-grandfather had received. The vision of world evangelism has been expansively inherited through generations. The quiver is filled with the arrows of hope to pass on the vision to even more generations to come. However, our hearts are filled with grief of loss. I pray and trust that this great grief will turn into power as we continue to serve the vision of the world mission. And I will let him read the last sentence, and then he has a few words to say. But let me say this today. I believe that David Bell was baptized 3 times. He's baptized in water. He's baptized with the Holy Spirit. And as we saw last night and today, and that's just a little touch of it, that he was baptized in love. That's what I want to remember about him, baptized in love. And so I want to say to Jody and to Matt, Michael, Mark, Micah, Mitchell, and your wife and children, I'm going to borrow a word from the statements made by Matt in our Wednesday night service. Together, we can make it.
Dear brothers and sisters, my name is Nobuo Takeuchi. I'm from Japan. Today, I'm here. I represent all of brothers and sisters in Japan. Pastor Misaka, who is chairman of Japan Next Towns Crusade, gave me a message. I want to share this message with you. He said, please remember that your Japanese brothers and sisters, as well as pastors in Japan, share this terrible pain that you are going through. However, I prayed and trust that this grief will turn into power of we continue to serve in the vision of the world mission. Thank you very much. God bless you.
You can say the Lord is faithful, has been faithful to you. As we enter a new year, you're confident in the Lord's faithfulness. Is that your testimony today? Good, mine too. Thy faithfulness
to me, oh my Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, oh Lord. When I was sick, you healed my body. When I was down, you lifted me up. Great is thy faithfulness unto me, O my Lord. When I was hungry, you gave me food to eat. When I was thirsty, you gave me living water to drink. Great is thy faithfulness unto me.
Bless the Lord. A lot of people today who think they have a long, long time before they either die or before God comes back for his church. But we are not guaranteed another day, another hour, or even another minute. This could be the moment when the Lord comes back for his church. Are you going to be a part of his church? You could die tonight. You're not guaranteed any more time. This is a song that simply asks, how long? How long will you wait until you accept the Lord as your Savior and until you give your whole life over to Jesus Christ?
How long will you wait, my friend? How long? Jesus Christ is just standing by. How he longs to hear your heart's cry. So tell me, how long will you wait? How long? Supreme sacrifice. There's nothing left for you to do but just believe and you can come through. How long will you wait, my friend?
Jesus Christ is just standing by, and how he longs to hear your heart crying out to him. So how long? How long will you wait, my friend? How long? Well, tell me, how long will you wait till you give your life to him? You must not wait any longer, but just give your life over to him this very hour. This very minute, you can do it right now. Don't wait any longer. Give your life over to Jesus Christ right now, and he will meet you right where you are. How long?
Everywhere I go, I see you. believe I'm supposed to say a few remarks, if I can. I want to honor my pastor, my friend here today. For those that may not know me, my name is Doug Pittman, and little did I know in 1993 when God redirected mine and my family's life from the state of Georgia like an arrow that was in the air. He reached up and he snatched it and he aimed it toward Texas. Little did I know at that point how deeply impacted my life was going to be. Because God had a gift for me. Didn't even know it. And that gift for me was Dave Bell. I love that man. I needed him. God knew it. Through knowing Dave Bell, the Lord brought me across a threshold of greater understanding, the church, the purpose of the church, worldview, passion for the presence of God, and under his leadership, God chose him to develop me. I miss him. I just hope I could have been a blessing to him as he was to me. And I'm so thankful that God gave me a season in my life with Dave Michael Bell. Changed everything for me. How many of you out there can agree? Changed you too? He wasn't only my pastor, he is my best friend. God gave us a bond where we trusted one another. I could trust him with my life. I knew that every moment Dave Bell had my best interest in mind. He was thinking about me. He was thinking about my family. And of course, he was thinking about everybody, but he made it so personal. And he filled the love. How we need more Dave Bells in the earth today. I just think of a scripture, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. He was selfless. Psalm 78, 72 says, so he shepherded them according to the integrity of his heart and guided them by the skillfulness of his hands. That's just all over Dave Bell right there. You know, I want to honor him, a man of impact, a man of influence, a man of integrity. If you ever remember anything about Dave Bell, he was an inspired worshiper, psalmist, worship leader. He loved God's word. He loved prayer. Oh, how he's been preparing this house for prayer. My house shall be called a house of prayer. But greater than all that, he was a man of integrity. Dave Bell has a good name because of his integrity. He laid hold of integrity, and integrity laid hold of him. Have you come that close to Jesus to where he has laid hold of you? The Word of God has laid hold of you. The Spirit of God has laid hold of you. The mind of Christ has laid hold of you to where you're all in and there's nothing left except for me to live is Christ. That's Dave Bell. I had an opportunity to serve with Dave since 1998. I was 4 years old. Don't we all wish?
I want to say to Jody and the entire Bell family, Nathan, Dave was a gift to me. I learned much from him. Man, we went through a lot together. How many knows that when you're involved in the ministry, you have some challenges? You bear many burdens. But there's also the celebrations and the joys and the breakthrough. Man, we experienced it all together. It's just awesome. I talked to him a lot. And I know how he thought about you. He loved you. He loved you. He loved you. He's a man of integrity. See, it wasn't so much that he was concerned about his personal life, but he knew that he had to be a man of integrity for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of the work, for the purpose of the church. He must have integrity. Do you understand what I'm saying? It was so beyond him. Everything mattered for the work of God, and he loved to serve God, and he was passionate about his walk with God, and therefore he chose integrity. You see, you've got to choose integrity. And we're here to pay our respects today. You know what the greatest way you could pay your respect to Dave Bell would be? To take integrity for yourself. Make it a part of you. Live by the standard of the Word of God and by the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Take that characteristic of integrity and make it yours, both young and old. Integrity defined means the quality of being honest, having strong moral principles, moral uprightness. Dave Bell would always choose integrity over success of any kind. He always would choose integrity over personal gain of any kind. He was committed to integrity. How many of you out there are committed to integrity? Amen? Got two over here. Brother Wayne, it's time for that altar call. Nice. Integrity guided his decisions. Integrity guided his relationships. Integrity guided his ministry vision. You never had to worry about the motives of Dave Bell. Pure, Christ-like. He modeled this for us. Just one example. He would pull the staff together, and he had this little seminar for us. And, of course, the staff is like, oh, staff seminar, you know. It was called Living Above Reproach. This was important to him. So he would bring the staff together. Even though we had already had the seminar, he brings us and he gives it to us again. That's the privilege of lead pastor, you know. And it was about living a life to where no one can point a finger at you and accuse you of unrighteousness. Living above reproach. He would take us through that and, you know, practically talking to Matthew, you know, there's times he would go purchase an item for himself, but you know he's going to use it for the church. Everything Dave possessed was probably used by the church, you know. And he could have taken tax-exempt status. Nobody ever known it, because you know you're going to just use it at the church all the time. No, this is my item. This is my personal item. I'll pay my tax. We're going to do this right. That's Dave Bell. Oh, I love him. What a gift. What a gift. What a gift. If
faithful father, faithful pastor, faithful friend, a man of integrity with a good name. God bless you.
Good morning, Destiny family. Oh, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's a sad, but it's also a joyous occasion because we know where our brother is, and those of us who know the Lord as he knew the Lord will be able to see him. So we know where he's rejoicing. Two scriptures that came to my mind, and I believe the Lord brought to my heart when I heard about Pastor Dave's passing. Psalms 31:15 says, "My times are in your hands. My times are in your hands." And Psalms 90:12, "So teach us to number our days that we may get us a heart of wisdom." Only God knows. Only God knows. Only God knows. Another song that came to mind was, "When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory." And David is up there singing and dancing now before the Lord. He's singing and dancing before the Lord now. Legacy, in other words, David likes to look up words, and I'm a person that like to look up words. I got little stickies in my office where I've got, you know, Mr. Cox likes to look up words. Legacy, I thought it was going to be something grand, and it says, "Anything handed down from or as from an ancestor to a descendant." David's five boys, his wife Jody, the love of God that he showed to all of us, his church family, and the love of his family. I was talking to someone at work of how, you know, a lot of ministers we hear, they're gone all the time and they're not with their families, but David was always with his family. He was always with his family. We're going to sing. I'm going to ask you all, don't ever turn back, no matter how difficult life may be. The song we're going to sing is, "I open my mouth to the Lord and I won't turn back." That part was not, but that's part of the words.
I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to see. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go. I shall go to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go. I shall go to see what the end's going to be. I open my mouth to the Lord.
I open my mouth to the Lord.
I open my mouth to the Lord. I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go.
I shall go.
I shall go.
I will go.
I will go.
I shall go.
I shall go.
I will go.
I will go.
I shall go.
I shall go.
I will go.
I will go.
I shall go.
I shall go.
I will go.
I will go.
I shall go.
I shall go.
To see what the end's going to be.
And everybody said amen. I know you've been here a while. Just turn around somebody and tell them, I love the Lord with all my heart today. I greet you today on behalf of Mark Witt, who is not able to be here this morning. Mark had concerts scheduled all week this week. Talked to him last night, and he wanted me to greet you and let you know that all week this week he's been honoring his friend and your friend, Dave Bell, by singing, of course, Lord, I Seek You in Spanish, and has honored his friend this week to thousands and thousands of Hispanic-speaking and people from all over the nation. He'll be here Sunday morning. And so good to have Mike Heron here today, who he's going to be my keyboard player for a moment, and I promise you I'm not going to sing. One of the boys said, we were talking and is it proper etiquette to have Dave sing at his own funeral, and kind of thought about that, and I said, no, it would be improper for me to sing at my funeral, but not for Dave. You know, I want to say something to you folks today about the life of Dave Bell, and it is this. It's not the longevity of a man's life that makes the biggest difference. It really isn't. It's the legacy he leaves when he's gone. It's what you leave when you leave that makes the biggest difference. And today, my friend Dave Bell, he lived life well, and he left well. And he left us a wellspring of legacy. If I could think of one word about my friend Dave Bell, and I have to say how I first came in touch with this man of God and this friend was my intense need and our intense need for someone who could lead worship at a youth camp. And I'll never forget David Hartley in a meeting of desperation. He said, I think my worship leader will come. And we said, really? Well, can he play an instrument? Yeah? I think he'll bring the whole band. The whole band? And that's how my friendship with Dave Bell began. When I came face to face with a man of worship. You know, it's been a fun ride. Whew. I could think of one word about him, it would be passion. This man lived life to the max. He was passionate about life, and his passion was contagious. How many of you have ever been infected with his passion? You know, I thought about the two disciples on the road to Emmaus when they had lost their Lord and didn't know that he had been raised from the dead, and he came beside them and walked with them and talked with them. And the Bible says when they realized who it was, they said, did not our heart burn within us? That was the way Dave would be with me and with you. Just a little time with Dave and his passion would rub off on you, and his contagious demeanor. Allow me to state the obvious for just a few moments. This man was passionate with his love for fast cars. If you've ever been with him in his M5 late at night down I-10, you know what I mean. He was passionate in his love for others, and I saw that in his sons this week and in his family. I see a little Dave in all of them. He loved you, and he loved his family, and he loved the church, and he loved missionaries. He was passionate about that. He really was passionate for his family. You've seen that. These five sons. And you know, I was thinking about him and how he's raised his sons, and I thought, you know, he raised five great boys. But then I realized, no, he didn't do that. He raised five great men. And as one brother already said, he's had to take five to take his place. So he was a passionate man. Passionate for his family and passionate for missions. Love missionaries, and that's the DNA of his life, and that's the DNA of this church. But most importantly, as has already been obviously stated, he was most passionate about his love and worship of God. He really was a man of worship. He was passionate about that. It wasn't his fantastic instrumental skill that caused him to worship God. It wasn't his phenomenal songwriting. Let me just stop and say, I believe Dave Bell was the best psalmist in all the world. These songs will never die. But it wasn't his instrumental, vocal, songwriting skills, and it certainly wasn't his desire for financial gain that caused him to write songs. It was because he loved God with all his heart, and he wanted to worship the Lord. It was his uncompromising commitment to make sure God was glorified. That's the reason I know Dave Bell. What a man of worship. What a man of worship. And in this room today, there are musicians, songwriters, worship leaders, psalmists, all whose lives have been dramatically altered by the contagious infection of Dave Bell, a man of worship. Yes, he left us a legacy of love for his fellow man. He left us a legacy of love for family. He left us a legacy of love for the fulfillment of the Great Commission. But I believe most importantly, he left us a legacy of worship. To be a people who worship God with their whole heart. To be wholehearted. To be forever committed to lifting up the name of Jesus. If you're here today and you are a musician, a songwriter, a singer, a worship leader, and your life has been radically changed by this passionate man at the place of worship, I want you to stand wherever you are. Worship leaders, singers, musicians. Now you have a big challenge. Because the song of the Lord to continue to live. And not just the songs that Dave wrote, but could I tell you today, by the prophetic word of the Lord, there's a whole new song arising. God wants to use you. See, the scripture says unless a seed falls into the ground and dies, it abides alone. But if it dies, it can bring forth much fruit. I believe there's an explosion of worship going to resound around this world. Today I speak over these musicians and singers and psalmists and worship leaders a brand new song. And let the life of Dave Bell inspire you and the song that came through him move you to a new level of passionate worship. To worship him with your whole heart. It's not the longevity of a man's life that matters the most. It's the legacy he leaves. It's what you leave when you leave. And yes, we say goodbye to our friend, but we welcome a whole new song. Father, today may the song of the Lord live in us. May the worship of God arise in us. Put a new song in our heart. Even praise to our God. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came upon me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, and that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle he shall hide me. He shall set me high upon a rock. Now my head shall be lifted up above all my enemies all around me. Therefore I will offer sacrifices of joy in his tabernacle. I will sing praise. Yes, I will sing praise to the Lord. You may be seated.
Crowns me he's from the west. He's removed our sins from us, and all that's in me, bless.
Thank you, Dave, for being our friend. For being such a terrific father and brother, son, grandfather. Thank you, Dave. Thank you, Dave, for your song. Your love, your kind words. Thank you, Dave. We will miss you. We look forward to those moments when we will worship together forever with the Lord that you love so much. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Thank you. Wow. Thank you all for being here. Really, really appreciate y'all guys' love and support. A few things about my dad. Just a great dad. Really appreciated him. Loved him with all my heart. I was able to see him the day he died. I was having a hard time sleeping. Sunday, I couldn't go to sleep Saturday night. And I saw him getting ready to leave for church. And it was something, it was a moment I'll never forget. I just got to talk to him for a little bit. I just asked him, you leaving? He said, yes. And I just asked him, I just said, can you pray for me that I'll have some good energy to make it through the day? I had no idea what was going to happen. I just was so tired. And so he said yes, and so he prayed for me and embraced me, and I looked him in the eyes and I told him, I love you, Dad. He said he loved me too, and I told him I appreciate him. He was a great dad. He said thanks, and he made his way out. And in the midst of everything, that really helps me is that no matter what he was going through, how stressed he was with work or whatever, he would always thank God for everything in his life. And he would just say praise God or always have an encouraging word. And that is just what helps me get through times like this. It's just we have to just look forward to everything God has planned for us and in our lives. And you know, that's just what I feel like I should be telling y'all guys. Is that the Lord is good, He reigns. And to Just move forward, press on. Take every day. Take every day one step at a time, one day at a time, and move forward. Thank you.
Wow, that was awesome. I tried to think last night about, you know, what I was going to say about Dad, and there's way too much, you know, way too much I could say. So I started to write some stuff down, and after I wrote like three things down, I was a wreck. So I wrote down prayer. He loved to pray. Taught that by his mom, I'm sure. She was a prayer warrior, and he really taught me how to pray. We would have lots of kind of talks sometimes, because he liked to pray loud, and he liked to shout and pray to God, and I was more of the quiet guy, you know, got my prayer closet, Dad, and but he was working on me, and so that's something that'll be with me. Every morning, he'd come by, say, "Dear Jesus, bless," and he'd sit there and think, "Which boy is this?" Micah. Bless Micah. That was the hardest part of his prayer, because the rest of it was the same. Dear Jesus, bless Micah. Help him to have a great day. Help him keep him safe, healthy, protected in every way. Help him to grow strong. Be a mighty man of God. And so I was thankful for that. Something else I wrote was that he valued people. And lastly, I wrote that he loved all. And just what's breaking me up is just seeing all y'all, because he loved every one of you so much. He really did. He meant it when he said it. I love y'all too. I just want you to know that. Y'all have been such a ministry to me for the past few days. Also, something that has been entertaining my thoughts, I haven't been thinking too much yet about seeing him again, just because, you know, it's all happened so fast. But, you know, there's another David that wrote some songs, and just thinking about the two of them up in heaven making music is kind of amazing. That's been kind of a help as well. But ultimately, you know, seeing these pictures, he was just such an amazing dad. I know y'all know him as pastor, and we've been hearing a lot about that, but this is really a good time to just hear about what an amazing dad and father he was. He was an amazing husband to my mom, and he, you know, they were sweethearts. And that's a side of him I know y'all might not have seen a lot. But there was that soft part of my dad that you could really connect with. And I know a lot of you did. You felt a personal touch from him. So I guess I just, you know, sorry for crying a whole bunch, but I just wanted y'all to know, it's kind of in a kind of a selfish way, I loved him so much. And cared for him so much. He cared for all of us so much. And he really gave every bit of his life to his family and his church family. So thank you.
It's really awesome seeing all of y'all here today. It's an army of people that I can feel are standing strong. And y'all guys have been a great support to our entire family. I just want to thank y'all for that. Tell y'all that we truly do love each and every one of y'all and appreciate each and every prayer, each and every word that y'all have shared with our family. And just wanted to get that out of the way in case I break down. So, my dad, he really was my best friend. A lot of young people knew me, still know me, and there'd be a lot of times I'd be invited to stuff, and I wouldn't go because I would rather hang out at home with my best friend. And I know a lot of people might have thought, well, he's keeping you from having fun, but that wasn't the case. I wanted to be with my best friend. And I just wrote down a little bit of things. He forced potential out of you, out of me. He saw potential in me, and he let me know every single day that God is going to do something great in my life, that he is equipping me. And he was the coolest man in the world. And if he wouldn't have been the one telling me that, I don't know if I would have believed it. But I didn't have a choice but to believe it. Because if Dave Bell is telling me that he believes in me, I mean, that just really pumped me up. And that's going to keep pumping me up. Because I know for the rest of my life, I'm going to hear those words that he believed in me. And I know he believed in a lot of y'all guys. And I know a lot of y'all here can say, you wouldn't be where you are today if it wasn't for him showing potential in you and speaking into your lives. He was a man of forgiveness. He had a lot of opportunities to do that with us guys. But no matter what we did, and we did a lot. We did a lot of crazy things, a lot of stupid things. But he was always there for us to let us know that he loved us. And there's nothing we could ever do that would make him stop loving us. And not a day went by where I ever questioned my dad's love for me or for my family. And whenever, you know, I was just thinking about this just while I was sitting at the front. Whenever I have an answer in life, a question in life, I know to go to the Word of God for for the answer. But from now on, whenever I'm looking for an example of how to handle something, I'm going to look to how my dad handled things. Because he was just the greatest man. And he just knew how to handle things. And he always had the answer. He really was the smartest man I will confidently say that I ever knew. If I had a question for anything, whether it was schoolwork or cars, sometimes girls, he would go on, and he wouldn't just give me an answer. He would give me a textbook full of answers. And I don't know how one man can have so much knowledge on so many different categories. And I know that's how he was able to relate and be friends with so many of y'all, because if y'all had an interest, he probably perfected it, and he could tell you all about it. And he was a very giving father. He gave us everything we needed. He always made sure that we had what we needed. And a lot of times that meant sacrificing stuff that he had. A couple months ago, we kicked him out of his office so we could go and live with him, me and my wife. And he was overjoyed to have us there. He set up another office and this awesome sound system, and, you know, it sounded better than anything I could put together, and that's just how he did things. But he was very giving. One story, I know we could all share millions of stories, but just this last year when me and my wife just got married, we were still on our honeymoon, but we were back in San Antonio. We drove up to Kerrville. We love Kerrville. He made Kerrville amazing to us. There you go. If someone can make Kerrville amazing, it's my dad. But anyways, we were driving up, and my car just completely fell apart. We were like 2 minutes away from exiting. It was a Saturday afternoon, and the first thing I thought was, I got to call my dad, because I know he'll come help me. And it was like, it took us probably 50 minutes to get where we were at. He was there in 30 minutes. And his M5, that probably would have been a fun ride to be in. And he helped us out. And he stayed with us the whole day, took care of us, bought us lunch. My dad loved us. And he loved you, Mom. And I know all five of us guys are going to have that example of a father and of a husband and of a friend that he invested every single day into us. And he'll be missed. He sure won't be forgotten. And I just want y'all to know I love each and every one of y'all. I appreciate y'all.
Going to be tough for me, as it has been for everybody, but thank you all for being here. All of you who travel from out of town, means a lot to us that y'all are here. haven't even gotten started yet. I kind of did what Micah did last night. I laid in bed, exhausted from talking to hundreds of you, honored to see all the people that my dad's life had touched. And it was just amazing. But begin to just jot down a few words. And the first word that came to my mind was, Dave Bell was my hero. In so many different ways. He taught me how to play the drums. Bought me a drum set, and I didn't really even think I liked the drums. He gave me my one and only drum lesson. Show me a 4/4 beat. And it was his belief in me that allowed me to become a halfway decent drummer. It's because I knew he believed in me, like Mark said. And I know that a lot of you could say he was your hero too, in different ways. He taught me how to be a father. I've never heard him yell at me or any of my brothers, ever. He's never yelled at my mother, ever. And that's amazing. And that's the truth. But the reason he was such a hero to me is because when I think of Dad, I just think real. He was a real man. I can try to be a real man. We can all have our moments where we feel good. But he was real 100% all the time. What he said up here, he lived out every day. Oh, he was my best friend, as he was to all five of us, and to my mother. There isn't anything I'd rather do than do it with my dad. He led by example. If we are who we are today, we have faith today because my dad was a man of faith. He led by example. If he wanted to instill something into us, he showed us how to do it. He was a man of integrity, as Doug spoke about. Every day he lived it to the glory of God. Never wavering in any way. He took every moment seriously like it was his last. Matt was saying the other day how he used to drive us nuts. We'd be watching a random show on TV, and he's like, you know, if you spent as much time watching this show as you did playing the keyboard, think of how good you'd be. And then you just walk out. And then we feel convicted, you know? And it's the truth. He was so passionate about doing things that mattered, doing things that he knew would have an effect on other people. And he's amazing, an amazing man, real in every sense of the word. I want to read a verse that my dad has. How many of you remember the dartboard story from one of his Sunday messages? Okay, some of you guys. He has in his office right now a verse. On the dartboard, he printed out a verse and put one of the darts in it. The verse is Genesis 22:18. says, in your seed, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed because you have obeyed my voice. And he believed that for you and for us. And we have hope in that because we know he's obeyed God's voice. And God's going to honor that. And I tell you, it's been really tough for me personally, processing all this. If it wasn't for my dad's faith in the Lord and seeing how he's come through so many different struggles in his own life, you know, health things, church things. There's so many times where my dad could have been mad at God or upset, but he always looked at us and said, we got to have faith, and we got to pray, and we got to believe. So that's what I'm doing today. And it was his example that allows me to do that. I love my dad, Dave Bell. Greatest man ever lived, in my opinion. Thank you for leading us as sons. Thank you for teaching us the importance of worship and prayer. And just thank you for teaching us how to all be real men. We love you. We'll see you soon.
We're on the home stretch. We're almost done. Sort of. With this part of the day. I just, on behalf of the Bell family, the entire Bell family, my mom, I just want to thank all of you guys for just the outpouring of love and support and encouragement and scripture and words that you've just been speaking into our lives. I want to thank Sam and Beverly Walker. You guys have been a rock for us this week. I want to give them a hand. I want to thank the church elders, the elders of Destiny Church, that have just stood by us in a time where there could be uncertainty, where doubt could come in, where division can come in. These men have risen up in unity and have surrounded our family in love. So I want to honor them today. And then I just want to thank the whole church family. Because you guys, I mean, every night when I've gotten home this week, I've jumped on Facebook real quick. And I've just kind of scanned through some of the stories and the testimonies of the way my dad, the Lord used my dad to impact your life. And it's just been such an encouragement to me. Such an encouragement to me. To see that a life spent for the Lord can really matter. That when you spend your life for the Lord, it can make a difference. And this, you guys are the testament to that. So I want to honor you guys today. My brothers have stolen all of my my stories. Not all of them, but they've really kind of treaded a lot on what I wanted to say. But my dad was absolutely a genius. I mean, he was absolutely brilliant. And sometimes, you know, people would come and they'd talk to him after church, and he would stand there and they'd be pouring out his heart to them. And I could just see it in his eyes. He's got their problem solved. He knows exactly what they need to do. He's got their next week planned for them. He's got the next year planned for them. He's got it ready to go. And I could just see it. He is beyond the problem that they were facing. But he would stand there, and he would love them, and he would open his arms and embrace them. And that was my dad. That was my dad. He never once made me feel dumb or inferior. My dad was a man who, his obsession was with details and with maximizing potential out of everything. The smallest thing, my dad would spend hours on.
hours just trying to get every last bit of juice he could out of whatever it was. And it drove me nuts. That just drove me nuts sometimes. But that was my dad, with cars, with musical equipment, with his boys, with his church. Every last bit of potential that he saw in people, he would get it out of them. Sometimes he would spend time with people. I'm like, Dad, why are you spending so much time with these people? But he saw something in people that at times I didn't even see, and especially they didn't even see in themselves. And he had a way of bringing the good in people out to the top, to the surface, believing in people until they could believe in themselves. And that was my dad. When he would speak on Sunday morning, sometimes he would really drive me nuts, because he would close his message with 7 points. He did this 2 weeks ago. He stood up here 2 weeks ago, and he said, in closing, I have 7 points that I want to share with you today. Somebody texted me a few weeks ago, or a week ago, when they were at an event, and the speaker closed with 4 points, and they're like, man, how long is this going to go? I said, this guy's got a ways to go, because Dad closed with 7 points last week. It's not even close. And then his points weren't points. They were paragraphs. They were paragraphs. I tried to write notes for my dad. You had to be a stenographer or something to keep up with him. Is that the right word? I don't know. And I was telling Sam yesterday, it drove me nuts sometimes. I'm like, Dad, there's no way. There is no way these people can assimilate the information dump you just did on them. There's no way. There is no way. That's how he thought. He could assimilate all of it. He could assimilate all of it. And I told Sam, I realize now that he had to get it in. He had to get it in. He had to get it in while he was here. The last series he did on prayer, Prayer Changes Things. Man, this is a masterpiece. A masterpiece of prayer and worship and flowing in the Spirit. It was. I said, Dad, each one of the points of your sermon could have been a 3-week series. Easily. If you didn't hear that series, you need to track that down. It will change your life. You know, this sudden passing of my dad, for me, has been the ultimate test of walking in the Spirit or walking in the flesh. Because in my flesh, I miss my dad so much. And I'm going to continue to miss him every day. I can't tell you how many times I picked up my phone this week to text my dad. Last night, I thought crossed my mind, man, I need to tell Dad how many people are here. This is crazy. But this is the ultimate test of whether we're going to arise in our spirits, in what we believe, in the things that we say we believe, or if we're going to let our flesh take over. While we long for him, and we're going to miss him, we have to have faith that he was in God's hands. The Bible says that life is a vapor. It is a vapor. It's here today and it's gone tomorrow. My dad spent every moment of his life maximizing it. Every moment. He never wasted a moment. He was always working it. Whatever it was, he was going to get the most out of it. If he ended up having to go somewhere he didn't want to go, he was going to get the most out of it. He was going to make the most out of every situation. He never wasted time. He would drive us nuts with that. I remember I'd sit at home and play video games after school, and I'd turn it down so I could hear the garage door open, because when he opened it up, I wanted to turn it off and go act like I was doing something productive. Most of the times, he wouldn't just say anything. He'd come in, and he'd look at us. He'd walk out. Because he loved us. Because he loved us. Nathan said, he shared the story with us yesterday about my dad's complications in the hospital. Every day of my dad's life was a gift. Every single day. When he had rheumatic fever when we were all little boys. Without God, we would have been raised without a dad. Without God's intervention. I honestly believe that with my whole heart. God has intervened in my dad's life over and over and over and over again. And that is the testimony of my family. And that is the heritage that I'm inheriting. That God, if he'll do it for us, he'll do it for you. And while we don't understand this, I don't understand it. It's beyond comprehension. My dad's testimony always was, God loves us. God's going to take care of us. God's going to provide for us. And I believe that still today. Do you believe that? We've spent a few minutes here today, most of the day kind of reminiscing, memorializing my dad. But I think it would honor my dad today to take a few moments and look to the future. To look beyond today. To look beyond this moment of hardship, this moment of grief, this moment of pain. On Facebook, I read a lot of stuff about, this is unbelievable. This is so sudden. This is tragic. I was just kind of pondering all the words that people were saying, using to describe this situation. And most of them I could identify with. But the word tragic, I couldn't identify with that. The reality is that my dad's passing could, in fact, be a tragedy. But it's really up to us. It's really up to you. If we arise to the call that God has on our lives, if this is somehow a springboard to a deeper walk with the Lord, to living every day in prayer and in worship and in focusing on the Lord, this will not be a tragedy. This will be, the hand of God will be all over this. On Monday night, I really broke down. I was weeping, just weeping bitterly. And I wasn't weeping because my dad had passed, but I was weeping because I felt like we had missed some opportunities with him in recording his music. I really did. And so I was kind of weeping over these projects that we never got done. And my poor wife was trying to console me, and I was restless. I was wrestling really hard with this. I got up, and I began to pace and pray and pace and pray. How could this be, God? How could this be? And the verse the Lord just dropped in my heart that brought me so much peace, which I don't know how it could bring anybody peace, but it has just brought me peace and it has carried me through this whole week, is the kingdom of God suffers violence, but the violent take it by force. And if we become lackadaisical, if we put things on the back burner, if we continue to put things off, it will never get done. There are things in your life, there are callings on your life that you have sat on. There are people in this room who have sat on calls for 20 years. And because you received a word of prophecy or a word of knowledge, you think that it's automatically going to come to pass. And while God entrusts us with these things,
We have to rise up and take hold of what God has promised us. Just because God said that you have the opportunity, that you have the call, doesn't mean it's going to happen. You have to rise up. You have to become fierce about it. You have to become violent about it and take hold of it and lay hold of it and let nothing separate you from the call that God has on your life. My dad's favorite words was arise, and we put that scripture on the front. He wanted to get a custom plate on his BMW that said arise. And my mom's like, no, you can't do that. It sounds too scandalous. You know, this just sounds bizarre. I don't like that. And so he didn't do it. He honored my mom. But he initiated Arise to Pray. We had a conference here called Arise to the Call. That was really my dad's message, was to arise, to rise up, to take hold of what God has promised you, to get an idea, to see a glimpse of the promise of God and to reach out for it and to pursue it with everything that you have. Some of you this week are starting for the first time to get a glimpse of the call of God on your life. I want to tell you, arise today. Arise. You don't have to live life the way you've always lived it. You don't have to live life the way your parents lived it. Today can be a new chapter in your life. You can arise today. A few years ago, this past year, my dad just stood up here one Sunday and he said, I figured out my life message. And this is it. God can do more through you than you ever thought possible. And that was my dad's life message. And that's what he would want me to stand up here and tell you today. That God would do more through you than you ever thought possible. Wednesday, I shared with the church, and this is really for the church family here today, because I know this is tough. There's a lot of people who are hurting. There's a lot of people who have questions. But from my mother and from my brothers, I want to tell you that we're in this together. That you are just as much a part of our family as my dad was. You are our family. And we're in this together. And together we're going to make it. Together we're going to make it. I want to leave you with a lyric from my dad, a song that was on my dad's very first recording. And it's this. Rise up, O man of God. Take hold of that which is yours. For the Lord has given you authority. So rise up, O man of God.
Can we sing a couple songs this morning together? In a world of millions of songs around the world, there's no song like a Dave Bell song.
In the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. The right hand of the Lord, there is pleasure forevermore. In the presence, in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy, and the right hand of the Lord. There is pleasure forevermore, more of you in my life, more of your love and your power, more of you in my life, Jesus, more of you, less of me. Of me
in the presence of the Lord,
in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy, and at the right hand of the Lord, there is pleasure forevermore.
Your name. Today. When you're in the presence of a great man long enough, you start to believe that you can be great. How many here are feeling today that you can be great? Close in prayer today. My name's Jason King, and I love Dave. But I celebrate his legacy. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the life of our pastor, our friend, our mentor, the husband and father and grandfather, David Bell. Thank you for his impartation into our lives to be people of vision, to be people fully operating in our gifts, to dream and to dream big, to think and to think outside the box. Thank you for the enlargements of our hearts today and the challenge of his life to love more, to believe for more, to believe for cities, to believe for nations, to lift their voices in worship to you, the Almighty God, who is powerful, who is always good, who is always perfect, who is magnificent in all your ways, who is full of mercy and full of grace and full of comfort and full of strength. You, God, are the friend of sinners and the anointer of believers. God, may we carry a new sense of passion to give you our lives fresh and anew today. May we never back up. May we never back down. May we never compromise or turn from your destiny for our lives. And may we walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may we leave here today with the confidence in you, Jesus Christ, knowing that we are all kings and priests, purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ to rule and reign this earth with the hearts of servants. Let us carry Dave's legacy and your legacy to the uttermost parts of the earth. Jesus, we love you. We just love you. Thank you for the life of David Michael Bell. And we bless you for it today. In Jesus' name, all of God's people say, amen. Amen. Because we have just a couple announcements as we conclude the service, because of the size of the crowd and the need to proceed to the cemetery in a timely manner, if you greeted the family last night and you were able to view, we ask you that in just a moment when we dismiss, if you could go ahead and make your way to your cars, we would greatly appreciate that. It would allow for those who weren't able to greet the family or who weren't able to be here last night to come on by and to do that. The family will be here on Sunday morning to worship, and it will be great to see them here, so come and join us for that. Also, thank you for considering the family, the friends who have traveled from many miles and overseas. God bless you. They love you. Destiny Church loves you. So at this time, this concludes the service for David Bell. And this time we turn this over to the funeral directors.